Beijing loyalists Maria Tam and Rita Fan wade into debate on national anthem law. Local economic growth slows in the third quarter. US and Chinese presidents lay out competing visions for trade ahead of APEC summit. A local deputy to China's parliament doesn't expect people to stop booing the national anthem just because there's a law in place. Maria Tam's comments came as a Hong Kong delegate to Beijing's top lawmaking body.
Our daily life. To improve things, we must change our habits. Let's work together. Honor traffic rules at all times. Use public transport and walk instead of driving. If we reduce traffic jams, everyone benefits. Think privacy. Be smart online. Don't download suspicious mobile apps. Don't use an easy-to-guess password for all accounts. Installing a webcam without security settings? Footage could be intercepted. Ignoring privacy settings in a social network account? Personal data could be exposed. Don't use free public Wi-Fi recklessly. Delete preferred networks after use. Change online password regularly. Be smart with password security.
無論在工作上遇到多困难，我哋都会不偏不倚执行职务。All has ignited a heated debate here, since the anthem is commonly played on TV and radio stations before news broadcasts, leading critics to say it's unrealistic to require everyone to stand each time the song is heard.
携手灭罪，守护香港。
Purpose, and if it is part of the arrangement that the national anthem will be played and you're asked to stand up, then I think you should stand up. If you don't stand, it doesn't mean that automatically you're guilty of anything.
A member of Beijing's top legislative body urged those who disrespect the anthem to consider the divisive effect it was having on the rest of the community.
Any investor or enterprise who wish to set up shop in Hong Kong, if they take this group, this very small group, seriously, then the conclusion will be Hong Kong is politically unstable. And if Hong Kong is politically unstable, it will hurt our economy, it will actually affect our international image, and it will do us harm for the whole community. Not just for these few who want to exist.
我哋一早搞好晒，你边有得拣咧？我哋赚到就，
好人就我哋赚啦。
Riots comes less than a week after Beijing formally extended a law banning disrespect for the national anthem to Hong Kong. The law came into effect on the mainland in October and carries a maximum penalty of 3 years in jail. Anne-Marie Sim, TVB News. Hong Kong's economy slowed down in the third quarter, but as Caleb Leung reports, strong consumption and rebounding exports have led the government to increase its growth outlook.
Hong Kong's economy grew 3.6% in the third quarter, down from the second quarter's figure of 3.9%. But economists felt the overall outlook was a positive one.
This marked the fourth consecutive quarter of above trend economic growth. Taking into account the positive global economic outlook and the support from the resilient domestic demand, Hong Kong's economy should attain further solid growth in the rest of the year despite a higher base of comparison in the fourth quarter of last year. Therefore, the real GDP growth for 2017 as a whole is forecast at 3.7% in the current round of review, which is higher than the midpoint of the range forecast of 3-4%. As announced in August 1.
The government also said the residential property market continued to moderate in the third quarter, extending the trend that began in June. The number of residential property transactions fell from 18,900 in the second quarter to 13,200 in the third quarter.
Trading activity slowed down in the third quarter, and overall flat prices also saw a slow increase of only 1%. We believe that potential home buyers should stay alert to the trend of rising interest rates and the notable increase in housing supply in the pipeline.
Still, compared to the 1997 peak, overall flat prices in September were 97% higher. What's more, the housing affordability ratio worsened to around 68% in the third quarter. The government also adjusted its forecast for inflation for the year.
The headline consumer price inflation rate is now forecast at 1.5% instead of 6%.
This was due to slow increases in import prices and moderate local cost pressures. Caleb Liu, TVB News.
A passerby who claims he was assaulted by police during the Occupy protests was described as part of a mob. This came as the accused offender wrapped up his defense in court today. Frank Lee Chu returned to the court building today to face his charge of assault occasioning actual bodily harm. He allegedly assaulted a passerby with a baton when he dispersed a crowd in Mong Kok during the Occupy movement. In his defense, Frank Lee Chu stressed he was exercising his rights under the Public Order Ordinance to apply force to disperse a crowd and prevent crime. The former cop said he had no time to check if everyone coming his way that night was a pedestrian or protester. The alleged victim, Osman Chang, was just part of the mob. The prosecutor suggested that Chang was not a protester as he wasn't seen wearing a helmet, protective eyewear or holding a shield. Frankly, Chu disagreed. He said what prosecution described is a militant protester. Because Chang wasn't equipped that way doesn't mean he's not a protester. He added that Chang had every opportunity to leave the area. He's sorry if the man happened to be stuck in the crowd when police took action, but that's not something he can control. The superintendent, who has since retired, admitted to hitting Osman Chang's back with a baton, but never on the neck. He also questioned why Chang did not take photos of his neck injuries that night to prove his claim. Closing submissions will be made on Monday, and the magistrate said she will need 2 to 3 weeks to reach a verdict. Leaders from more than 20 countries have arrived in Vietnam to talk trade and security at the annual Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation Summit. But US President Donald Trump has already indicated America will be demanding trade deals tilted more in its favor. James Aiken reports.
Donald Trump landed in Da Nang today, ready to set the tone for a key trade summit. He told leaders that the United States will no longer put up with trade violations, cheating, or economic aggression.
Those days are over. We will no longer tolerate the audacious theft of intellectual property. We will confront the destructive practices of forcing businesses to surrender their technology to the state and forcing them into joint ventures in exchange for market access.
Although Trump was addressing a business conference of Asia-Pacific leaders, he repeatedly referred to the Indo-Pacific region and mentioned the importance of India. Trump said the U.S. is ready to make bilateral deals with any country in the region, but only on the basis of mutual respect and mutual benefit. APEC, which has long championed free trade, has been shaken by the Trump administration's America First policy. Since Trump abandoned the Trans-Pacific Partnership trade deal, the remaining 11 members have struggled to build momentum to keep it alive. Still, those leaders remain confident they will be able to hammer out a basic agreement without the U.S.
When we look at Asia, we see a noodle bowl of trade agreements already, as all these other countries around the world are moving forward on trade and getting better deals for their companies. The U.S. is falling behind, and that's the real problem for American companies.
Trump arrived in Vietnam after a stop in China, which mainland media has declared set a new blueprint for handling U.S.-China relations. Meanwhile, President Xi Jinping told leaders that globalization is irreversible and nations need to stay committed to economic openness.
Openness brings progress, while self-seclusion leaves one behind.
Xi urged more balanced and inclusive trade deals, and said China will significantly ease market access restrictions and treat all foreign businesses in the country as equals. James Aiken, TVB News.
To news in America now. The Republican Party's chances of keeping the majority in the Senate is now being threatened. This after a woman accused one GOP candidate of sexually assaulting her as a minor. Sonia Otero reports.
Crushing allegations against Senate nominee Roy Moore 1 month before the U.S. state of Alabama's special election. Leigh Korfman named and shamed him in the Washington Post over an encounter almost 40 years ago. She was 14 years old and Moore was 32 and single. She says he was an assistant district attorney when he drove her to his home. That's where he allegedly guided her to touch him in a sexual manner as he fondled her, but there was no sexual intercourse. He's also accused of dating other teenage girls when he was in his 30s in Alabama, where the age of consensual sex is 16. Moore, who currently has an 11-point lead in the Senate race, called the Post report garbage and fake news. He accused the Post of attacking him politically because the paper publicly endorsed his political opponent. Knowing if he loses, the GOP could lose their majority in the Senate, Republicans pressured Moore to quit the race.
If these allegations are true, Roy Moore should step aside for all the obvious reasons.
If that's true, I don't believe there'd be any place for him in the U.S. Senate.
President Donald Trump also called on Moore not to run unless he's being wrongly accused, and his administration concurred.
We need to listen to both sides, but at the same time, that hypothetical would be disqualifying for anyone in public office.
Reaction among voters was mixed.
If it was me, if somebody done me wrong, I would go ahead when the event took place, I would say something then. Why would I wait 30 years?
From what I've heard about his background, I guess I just didn't see him being that way.
I don't believe them at all. I just don't believe Roy Moore did that.
Moore plans to fight the allegations because he never backs down. Case in point, he was ousted from a judicial post when he refused to take down a monument of the Ten Commandments outside his courthouse. An ironic twist for a man who's now being morally challenged. Sonia Artero, TVB News.
Back locally, the Legislative Council spent a third day discussing the motion of thanks for the chief executive's policy address. Tonight, the motion was passed for the first time in 9 years. Winner Wong reports.
Debate on the motion of thanks entered its final stage this afternoon. Lawmakers discussed the rule of law, the relationship between the executive and the legislature, among other things.
What about proving people's confidence in rule of law? For example, stopping the implementation of co-location at the West Kowloon Terminus, or there should not be any abuse of the judicial system to prosecute political prisoners.
But Secretary for Justice Rimsky-Yun hit back, saying judges clearly spell out the reasons for their judgments, and no politics is involved in the courts.
If you just disagree with the judicial results, it doesn't mean that without any objective facts, you should arbitrarily come to the view that the judicial process is influenced by political factors.
There was also some filibustering. Raymond Chan triggered a quorum call at 4 o'clock. And the meeting was stopped for about 10 minutes. It was able to resume when a large number of pro-establishment lawmakers returned.
Mr. President, this is the third day of the debate. I hope Mr. Ray Chan would have called for a quorum count for the last time.
The last several policy addresses saw lawmakers fail to pass the motion of thanks at LegCo. The last time it was successfully thanked was in the 2008 to 2009 term. Winner Wong, TVB News.
There are concerns tonight that thousands of Filipino domestic helpers may not arrive in Hong Kong scheduled. That's after Philippine authorities issued a 3-week suspension on handling overseas employment certificates. The Philippine Department of Labor and Employment said the move was to protect the public from those who prey on Filipinos desiring to work overseas. From Monday, new applications for overseas employment certificates will not be accepted or processed. but this does not apply to workers hired by international organizations or members of diplomatic corporations. Hong Kong's Labor Department said it will follow up on the matter with the Philippine consulate. And in sports, and in the NBA, the Washington Wizards bounced back after a home loss to League West Dallas Mavericks with a 111-95 win over the LA Lakers. Alan Bookney reports.
There was plenty of Wall versus Ball hype coming into this one. Washington superstar John Wall against Lonzo Ball, the NBA's first overall pick in this year's draft. Ball hit a three-pointer here, but his season shooting was continued. He finished just 3 for 12 for 10 points. He did, however, add 8 assists and 8 rebounds. Ball hit a fadeaway jumper later in the third quarter to give the Wizards a 20-point lead. He finished with 23 points. The last time these two teams met, 2 weeks ago, the Wizards blew a 10-point lead going into the fourth quarter to lose by 3 points in overtime. They wouldn't let that happen this time. Bradley Beal with a three-pointer midway through the fourth to open a 14-point Wizard lead. He finished the game with 22 points. With the win, Washington moves to 6-5, a disappointing start for a team expected to challenge for the Eastern Conference title. The loss moves the Lakers to 5-7. Alan Brookney, TVB News.
As for Saturday's weather, the experts say we should enjoy fine conditions along with temperatures in the mid-20s. And that's the news. Thanks for watching. Good night.